During the Carboniferous period, huge forests of primitive plants spread through the low-lying swamplands. These swamps housed a lot of strange animals, fueled by the excessive amounts of oxygen the trees produced. Then, towards the end of the Carboniferous, the climate became drier and these forests fragmented. But some of the swamp forests remained well into the Permian, and life in the swamplands continued. But not everything living in these new swamps was so familiar. It is the early Permian, and terrestrial ecosystems have come a long way since the first creatures crawled onto land, but many primitive relics of earlier times remain. A lot of Permian plants were members of ancient lineages that originated before the evolution of seeds, so they still used spores to reproduce, like ferns do today. Ferns themselves were common in the forests, with some of them growing into trees that were 30 feet high. While ferns survive in large numbers to this day, many other primitive plant groups, like the Lycopsids and Equisetopsids, are much less common in modern times, consisting of only a few small varieties. Their decline had already begun in the Carboniferous, but you could still find 100-foot-tall Equisetopsids towering above the rest of the forest in these Euro-American swamps of the early Permian. Nevertheless, these plants were disadvantaged by their reliance on spores to reproduce. Since spores dry out easily, plants that produce them are restricted to wetter areas. But not all Permian plants were so primitive. Many early seed-producing plants were present, including some of the earliest conifers, cycads, and other gymnosperms. Their use of seeds to protect their embryos meant that they could colonize drier environments than other plants could, but they were becoming more and more common in the swamps as well. The atmospheric oxygen levels had not changed much since the Carboniferous. They were still at about 35%, nearly twice the modern level. And just like in the Carboniferous, this meant that land arthropods could grow enormous, since their primitive respiratory system doesn't allow them to grow large if there isn't enough oxygen in the air. The largest terrestrial arthropod ever, the 10-foot Arthropleura, still roamed the swamps, and the skies were still ruled by giant relatives of the dragonflies. Meganeuropsis permiana, the largest known insect of all time, was one of them. It had a wingspan of nearly 3 feet across. Although these giants ruled the skies, the roach-like Blatopterans, among the most abundant insects at the time, inhabited the leaf litter, and ancient paleodictyopteroid lineages could still be found feeding on the plants. Among the arachnids, there was the usual assortment of spiders, scorpions, whip scorpions, and the extinct trigonotarbids, all of which had already been established for a long time. By now, bivalves had spread to fresh water, including the waters permeating the swamps. Among the gastropods, snails had lived in marine environments since the early days of the Paleozoic, but starting in the Carboniferous, they also started to invade fresh water, and by the time the Permian rolled around, terrestrial snails had colonized the land, although these snails were likely unrelated to today's land snails. Higher up on the food chain, freshwater sharks were still present. Older fish groups like the Acanthodians and Sarcopterygians were much rarer than they used to be, but one group of Sarcopterygians, the tetrapods, was doing well. Most tetrapods at this time belonged to more primitive groups that still laid their eggs in water. Today, the only living tetrapods that do this are modern amphibians, but in the Permian you could still find a huge variety of these creatures that have since been lost to time. Unlike modern amphibians, they had not yet lost their scales, so they couldn't breathe through their skin, but a lot of them probably possessed gills in addition to their lungs. Creatures like these had been hit hard by the shrinking of the swamplands at the end of the Carboniferous, but many of these groups managed to stick it out. Some of them were closer to modern groups, but some were far more basal than any living tetrapods. Scientists seem to have a hard time agreeing on where certain organisms fit into this family tree. Regardless, these groups contained multitudes of strange forms, From insect eaters to terrestrial herbivores to legless swimmers to large ambush predators like the Areopids, which could grow up to 10 feet long. The Areopids belong to the Temnospondyls, which is the group that most scientists seem to agree evolved into modern amphibians, the Lysamphibia. One Temnospondyl from this time, Gerobotrechus hattani, is thought by some to be the earliest known Lysamphibian. On the other end of the tetrapod family tree, the reptiliomorphs were still common as well. This group is thought to contain many of the lepospondyls, like the famous Diplocallis. It also contained several more terrestrial groups, like the diadectomorphs. Among the diadectomorphs were aquatic carnivores like Limnocephalus, but this group also included the only primitive tetrapods that ever evolved to be herbivorous, such as Diadectes itself. But in the last 20 million years, a new kind of reptiliomorph has joined these ancient ecosystems, one that you'd be hard-pressed to find in a Carboniferous forest. You may remember that the Carboniferous period saw the dawn of the amniotes, tetrapods that had watertight skin and, crucially, eggs with watertight shells that could be laid on land instead of in the water like amphibians. All fully terrestrial land vertebrates, from reptiles to birds to mammals, are members of this group. Before the end of the Carboniferous, amniota had split into two main groups, the sauropsids and the synapsids. While there are a few features of the skull that distinguish the two groups, both of them generally had the same primitive amniote look at this point in their evolution. One obvious difference between the synapsids and sauropsids, though, is that the synapsids got big. By the end of the Carboniferous, there were 10-foot synapsid carnivores and herbivores prowling the swamps, and these new groups continued into the Permian, evolving into many shapes and sizes. They represented the Earth's first terrestrial megafauna. The land was dominated by these strange creatures, and the swamps were no exception. However, at this time, their ecology was very different from the large land animals of today. Large herbivores were rare, and rather than a simple plant to herbivore to carnivore food chain, these food chains were more similar to aquatic ones, a long series of predators being eaten by larger and larger predators. There was still a ways to go before more modern food chains evolved. Not all swamps in the early Permian were like those of Euramerica. Different regions had different mixtures of these plant groups, and some fared better than they did in these equatorial swamps. Towards the Siberian end of Pangaea, the giant primitive seed plant Chordates was more common. Meanwhile, in the southern, colder parts of Pangaea, there were swamps dominated by early conifers, ginkgos, and a seed plant called Glossopteris, one of the most successful plants of all time. And in the east, more primitive Carboniferous varieties of plants found refuge on the islands that would one day become China. These islands were some of the few places where you could still find the bizarre Lycopsid trees in abundance. Many millions of years later, when the other wetlands would succumb to the drier climate, these islands would serve as the last refuge of the primitive forests that once spanned the globe.